Welcome, bienvenidos to today's Core Coffee Chat on exploring the core conditions of health and well-being. I'm Nicole Lezin. I'm one of the local consultants, along with Nicole Young, who facilitates a countywide initiative called Collective of Results and Evidence-Based or Core Investments, which is a collective impact approach to achieving equitable health and well-being for all people across the lifespan in Santa Cruz County. Today's chat is generally about the core conditions for health and well-being, which is one of the key elements of the core investments framework. We'll describe them in more detail in a moment, but for some of you, this may be information you're already familiar with. For others, it may be a new concept. We are not going to cover specific information or application requirements in the core request for proposals or RFP that was released just today. But the information should be helpful if you're considering an application and also if you're not considering an application. And at the end of today's coffee chat, you'll hear about upcoming training and technical assistance or TA that is directly related to the RFP. And as you can hear, our core events are held bilingually in English with Spanish translation and interpretation thanks to our team members, Stella Lauerman, who will be doing the interpretation today, and Gisella Carrasco, who you're listening to now and translates comments and questions in the chat as well.
Thanks, Nicole. And I'm going to do a really brief overview of CORE. So again, it stands for the Collective of Results and Evidence-Based Investments. And it's both a funding model and a movement to achieve equitable health and well-being in Santa Cruz County using a results-based collective impact approach that's responsive to community needs. That's a lot of words in there, but we try to repeat those over and over just to make sure that they start to take on meaning. And we really try to remind ourselves in every learning session like this of the mission and vision of CORE that has equity at the center in both of those statements. And really through our CORE coffee chats and all these other learning events, really try to think about what does that mean in practice to put equity at the center. And so when we talk about equitable health and well-being, we mean that across the lifespan, all people have equitable opportunities to experience these eight interdependent and interconnected core conditions for health and well-being, meaning that opportunities and life outcomes aren't predictable for better or for worse by things like race, ethnicity, income, gender identity, sexual orientation, immigration status, zip code, or other defining characteristics. So this is what we're here to talk about today, and we'll certainly dive deeper into this. But also just want to point out that we always put equity at the center of this diagram to illustrate that we have to constantly examine our individual beliefs, our practices, our organizational ways of doing things to identify ways that we might actually be contributing to or perpetuating some of the very inequities that we're trying to eliminate and address, and that it's a constant reflection and learning process. And events like today's coffee chat and other trainings that you'll hear about more at the end of today are offered under the umbrella of the CORE Institute for Innovation and Impact. And really the CORE Institute is just the learning arm of CORE Investments. So Nicole and I, you may have noticed, host a variety of learning events and opportunities like these almost weekly gatherings as a chance to build shared knowledge and skills and learn about different tools and resources, all in the name of getting closer to that mission and vision for collective impact. Okay, so we're going to move right into our topic for today, but before we start defining the core conditions in more detail, we wanted to give everyone a chance to respond to this poll here. We wanted to get a sense of how familiar are you with the core conditions? Is it a concept that you are not at all familiar with and that's why you're here? Do you feel like you're someone that's heard about that phrase, core conditions, but you're really not sure what they are and that's why you're here? Do you understand the concept of the core conditions, but you're still trying to figure out how does that apply to your work? How do you use that concept in your work? Or do you work in an agency or with a collaborative that has actually aligned its work with the core conditions? We'll give everyone a moment to think about that, answer the poll, and then we'll share the results. So like the responses have slowed down. So I'm going to end the poll and share the results. So we see we have a pretty even spread here. We have some participants that are not all familiar and others that have heard about the core conditions, but not sure what they are. And about equal amounts of participants saying they understand the concept of core conditions, but not sure how to use it in their work. And others that are here and are part of agencies or collaboratives that have already aligned their work with the core conditions, which, you know, could also mean that you're still wondering what does that actually mean. So glad to have you all here. And again, you know, the core request for proposals was just released today, and we'll tell you more about how to find that at the end of today's session. But this concept of the core conditions is a central piece of the request for proposals. And so we're really glad that you're all here, or if you're watching this later, that you're taking the time to learn about the core conditions. We think that this will be really helpful as you're thinking about what you might apply for, or just how you might work together in different ways, even if you're not applying for funding. And so we wanted to show and kind of walk through an example of, you know, when we talk about the core conditions being interconnected and interdependent, we wanted to give an example of what we mean by that. So this is from a previous coffee chat we did over a year ago on early learning. And it was our way of thinking through, like, how are all of these different aspects of health and well-being related to each other? And so in this example, think about grade level reading. Like, so young children, students being able to read at the whatever grade level standards for their grade. There's actually a whole national campaign focused on helping kids be able to read at their grade level by third grade, because there's a lot of research out there about how closely reading levels and reading ability at the end of third grade is tied to later outcomes in lifelong learning and education. So that's one of our core conditions here. So things like academic growth, like high school graduation, there's research showing that it's connected to earlier outcomes like grade level reading. And one of the reasons why it's important is because they're around that time in kids' academic career, you know, kids are making this shift from learning to read in those early grades, from transitional kindergarten through third grade, to reading to learn in fourth grade and beyond. And so if they are still struggling or still trying to build those foundational reading skills, it just makes the learning harder and harder, right, as the content gets harder and harder throughout school. And so it means that, you know, there can be a greater risk of students being left behind or not being able to complete school, so not being able to, you know, earn a high school diploma if there are other things getting in the way in terms of earlier learning. And, you know, as we know, there's also a connection between lifelong learning and education and educational outcomes and being able to find jobs with wages that provide economic security and mobility later on in life. And so lifelong, those are two core conditions that are connected there. And, you know, without a stable job that pays livable wages, right, if there's, if that core condition of economic security and mobility isn't strongly in place, that just makes it much more harder, right, to find and maintain stable affordable housing and shelter, which in and of itself can then have a ripple effect on health and wellness, you know, physical, mental, emotional health and wellness, as well as choices about where to live and whether that's a safe and just community. So also connected there. And reading and learning in general are also affected by, you know, many other factors, both inside and outside of a classroom, including health and wellness itself in terms of access to healthcare and oral healthcare and access to healthy foods and opportunities for physical activity. So that health and wellness covers a lot of things in there. And learning environments themselves matter. So if students are in safe, healthy environments that are free from pollutants and lead and pesticides, they're much more ready and able to learn versus if they're learning environments that are adding or creating additional barriers. And being part of a thriving family is also an important contributor to early learning and school success. And schools themselves are physical and in many cases still virtual places where students can connect with caring adults and with their peers. They can be exposed to arts and diverse cultural experiences. They can participate in community service and other types of civic engagement. So all of those are forms of community connectedness, and those are also important contributors to school success. And equitable education systems are critical to creating safe, just communities for everyone. And so again, you know, we wanted to show these are just a few examples. We could probably keep going on and drawing lots of lines, you know, the red ones representing inequities or barriers, the gold lines representing assets or strengths and positive connections there. So we could keep connecting the dots. Ideally, we would want something like this that shows that how all these different elements of health and well-being are connected, but also the resources and the systems that support health and well-being and all those dimensions are also connected. And that's where the concept of collective impact and working together to create those strong connections comes into play. Okay, so that's a little bit of a preview of what we hope you'll be thinking about as we walk through and describe the core conditions. I'm hoping everyone received the reminder email that I sent out this morning that had an attachment to it, a two-page handout that looks like this. So basically, this is a copy for you. If you had a chance to print it out, that's great. We encourage you to kind of mark it up and write on it, draw on it as we're describing these core conditions. So we want you to think about in the agency that you work for or with, in the specific programs you're familiar with or working in, which of these feel relevant to the work that you do? Where do you feel like, oh yeah, we contribute to that impact. We do something that maybe doesn't create that impact throughout the whole community, but our work definitely is a piece of improving health and well-being in that core condition, in that particular impact area. Okay, so we'll explain this more as we go through it. We encourage you to, again, have your copy of this in front of you, write on it, draw on it. As you hear us describe core conditions and impact areas, you know, you might want to check off a box there if you're like, oh yeah, that's something we contribute to. If you find yourself marking off things on more than one condition, core condition, then draw lines between them, kind of like we showed you in that previous slide. So you're basically creating your own little map of these connections. So here it is in English. The second page of that handout was in Spanish. If you didn't get that email this morning or didn't have a chance to print it out, just grab a blank piece of paper and make your own little circles and lines and jot down some notes. Okay, so Nicole and I are going to take turns describing these core conditions and giving you a couple examples of what that could look like. And so Nicole, I'm going to pass it to you.
Thank you. So again, just want to emphasize that all of the examples we're about to share with you are really just to illustrate the different ways that programs or entire agencies or broader initiatives can connect to one or more of the impact areas within each core condition and also across core conditions. In practice, it's great if there are more points of connection or overlap across the impacts and the conditions, because as you all know, in people's lives, these issues and needs are connected as well. So the idea is that our ways of addressing them should be more connected and less fragmented and siloed. So for the health and wellness core condition about community members experiencing optimal physical, mental, social, emotional, behavior, and any dimensions of health across the lifespan, your work in this area might not necessarily be in one of those realms. It may be in physical health, which is what a lot of people think of with health, but other dimensions like the behavioral health that has become even more urgent for so many people and families during the pandemic, oral health care. It could be connecting people to that care. So maybe you're not providing the care itself, but you might be focused on what's listed here under impact one, equitable access to affordable quality care. Maybe you're educating people about an aspect of their health that can lead them to a behavior change. So for example, that would be something perhaps an impact three, behaviors that maintain or improve health. So there are many ways to connect to these impacts, and they overlap as well. And maybe your work falls more closely in one or the other, but these are just some ways to think about the different ways to connect to this core condition and what it's all about. So Nicole, back over to you.
Okay. The next one, lifelong learning and education. So by this, we mean high quality education and learning opportunities from birth to end of life. So we really do mean across the lifespan. And so here the impacts are laid out, kind of thinking about what comes first and what needs to happen in between, and then what ultimately might we want to be seeing. So starting with equitable access to high quality education and learning opportunities. So again, thinking of what that might look like across the lifespan, that, you know, starts with, you know, childcare, early care and education, could be after school programs, could be, you know, your typical K-12 education. It could also include things like career technical education and college and adult education. So again, we really want to think about what does equitable access to education and learning opportunities look like for all ages. And then impact two is really about what happens in a classroom environment or what happens in the learning environment. So that might be the quality of relationships with teachers or instructors. It could mean things like the school climate, so physical and emotional safety, are some of the things that we consider part of the quality of the environment. Impact three around participation. So that could be something related to, you know, ensuring or increasing enrollment or attendance or the level of engagement in a learning opportunity. Sometimes it means measuring or trying to decrease something more problematic like chronic absenteeism. But again, we're thinking about both youth and adult learners. So any of the programs that agencies offer that are geared towards education and learning, there's often an engagement and participation element of that as well. When we think about impact four, that's really speaking then to the skills and kind of educational achievements that we would hope to see as a result of providing support and services for education and learning. So often that's measured by things like academic and social emotional readiness, skills and growth. And again, there can be a variety of programs or strategies to achieve that. And then impact five is about educational attainment. So kind of what is that highest level or kind of endpoint? Could includes things like workforce readiness. You know, is the education's being offered helping prepare people for different careers and matching students' interests to workforce needs? So lots in that one.
And then the core condition related to economic security and social mobility covers a lot of issues like whether or not there are opportunities for stable employment, what leads to that, livable wage campaigns or efforts within industries or sectors, the basic needs for food security, the ability to afford basic needs for individuals and families, and then beyond that, for how families can accumulate wealth that leads to prosperity across generations, which is not evenly distributed in our society at all, as we know. So here again, we move across these impacts from basic economic activity that offers some of those opportunities or more opportunities or brings people into those opportunities in different ways. And again, links to some of the career education that Nicole just mentioned and lifelong learning and education. The higher levels of self-sufficiency that could involve, for example, programs that address financial literacy or directly address food insecurity, help people who are unbanked. Maybe in the impacts in impacts three and four that you see here for increased mobility and generational wealth, there would be things like programs or initiatives that support educational saving or help people attain home ownership in different ways. So those are the kinds of things that you might see as strategies and programs that lead to these kinds of impacts. And when you think back to that diagram with all the connecting lines, those are almost everything that we can think of in terms of the adversity that people face or the benefits of stability in their economic lives flow through this core condition one way or the other.
Okay, and the next core condition is thriving families. So by this, we mean safe, nurturing relationships and environments that promote optimal health and well-being of all family members across generations. And so you'll see in this one, the impacts are arranged by age group. So the overall impact that we want to see is resilience among children and youth, adults and older and dependent adults. And so there are a variety of things that we know of that are currently happening. So this is when you think about some of the work around trauma-informed care and adverse childhood experiences for, you know, addressing children and youth as well as adults. That's one thing that's relevant here, as well as programs or initiatives that really focus on breaking down isolation and try to support healthy aging in place, or that prevent abuse of older and dependent adults, or try to intervene early and rectify or mitigate those situations. So again, any of, you know, things like counseling or kind of prevention oriented programs could all fit under here. And you might notice too that there's some overlap between things that might fit under the thriving families core condition and the health and wellness core condition, especially when we think about, you know, optimal health status or health behaviors. So that's natural. We want to encourage people to think along those lines in terms of not everything has to only fit in, you know, one bucket or one core condition.
And then the community connectedness one is connected to others as well. So we really think about this as the idea of different ways of belonging and feeling like you're belonging in a neighborhood, in a community. Are there institutions that are welcoming, that people feel that they're part of one way or the other? What are the roles of, for example, the arts and culture in connecting people to each other and to those local institutions and offerings? And then civic engagement, the muscle of civic engagement. Do people participate in the process and feel that they have a voice in a political process in decision-making? And what are the ways that people can be brought into that process if they don't feel part of it? So there are many aspects of this because belonging can take so many different forms. Sometimes it's referred to as social capital, but it's that whole idea that whether it's a cultural experience or an advocacy or voting experience, that you as an individual or a family feel part of the things going on around you, and the programs and strategies and agencies that try to connect people to each other and to those efforts are the kinds of things that land in these impacts: connection to others, access to diverse community arts and cultural experiences, and increased civic engagement. And as Nicole mentioned, this is one where these kinds of connections and breaking down isolation between across people and organizations may be a byproduct of other work you're doing. So for example, we talked a couple of weeks ago about things like telehealth types of efforts that might connect people to healthcare, but they also serve to break down certain kinds of isolation. So again, encouraging you to think about all of these core conditions more broadly, not to find an only one core condition or niche to fit into, but where are those connections across them, even if one of them calls out to you more than others.
And then we include healthy environments as one of the core conditions, because we all need to be able to live in clean, safe, sustainable, natural environments. And and built environments and have infrastructure that supports health and well-being. And so this includes a range of things in this particular core condition. So everything from the quality of the natural environment and natural resources. So think of things like air and water and, and soil, like the health of, our natural resources. It includes things like climate change resiliency. So when we look at things like, I know City of Santa Cruz is currently working on their climate action plan and looking at things like, coastal bluff erosion or risks for flooding due to rising sea levels. And so it includes things like that. We also include things like safe, affordable, accessible recreational spaces under this impact here. And this is another one where it's partly about, our environments and what's accessible, what's healthy, what's safe. And again, another area where having safe, affordable, accessible recreational spaces can actually support or contribute to healthy outcomes in the health and wellness core condition. So another area where they might be connected. And then we also include safe, affordable, accessible transportation systems in here as well. It's partly an equity issue in terms of what that transportation system either creates access to or creates barriers to in terms of, other resources in the community, but also is it contributing to people's health and well-being, their physical, mental, emotional well-being.
And Nicole, talking about healthy environments, just mentioned the safety of the feeling of safety in an environment as well as health and clean air and freedom from pollution and those kinds of things. And a specific dimension of safety is having fair and humane approaches to making sure that people do feel safe, whether it's at home or at work or out in public or in their neighborhoods, and that the institutions that are responsible for safety foster trust and respect and dignity as part of that process. So you can see some of that reflected in the impacts here. So impact one, individuals and families are free from all forms of violence. So this could address things like child abuse and neglect, domestic violence prevention, neighborhoods and communities are safe. So what are the dimensions of well-lit neighborhoods, of having a fair justice system in impact three that deals with community-based crime prevention or handles incarceration rates in specific ways. As we heard in a previous core coffee chat from our county probation team, looking at equity issues and how those things are handled and resolved. So a lot of system-wide pieces of this, but also a lot of direct service provision and prevention through different aspects of working on safety and justice in the community.
Okay, and then our last one here, stable, affordable housing and shelter means an adequate supply of housing and shelter that's safe, healthy, affordable, and accessible. And so, and I'll just mention several of these when we were creating the concept of the core conditions, creating what we call the core results menu, which was where we laid out these impacts and identified some community level indicators that support those or relate to them. There were several of these core conditions where we looked to others for advice and recommendations that were, had much deeper expertise in these topics than we do. And so this is actually one of them where we talked to some folks at the county and their consultants focused strategies that were actually working on the housing and homelessness plan, a couple of years ago now, I think. And so they helped us think about what would be meaningful and relevant impact statements to include here and categorize it by an increased inventory of housing, especially affordable housing. So looking at just is there physically the availability of housing to match or to meet community level needs, and how affordable is it? And that was separate or it's worth thinking about differently from the availability of safe shelter when that is needed or necessary. And then the access to safe, stable, affordable housing is kind of speaking to, is it something where it's available, it prevents or reduces the likelihood of being houselessness or being houseless? And, you know, is permanent housing available and supported? And so we think of that as kind of like, again, almost like a spectrum or stages that, you know, might want to kind of look at in terms of housing and shelter. Okay, so those are all of the core conditions. That was the brief tour of the core conditions and some examples or thoughts about like what that actually means or what are some of the almost like ingredients of you know what contributes to those core conditions. We'll give you just a moment to think some more, and if you've been jotting down some notes, maybe you know draw a few more lines or make sure that you've kind of thought through or checked off some you know as many impact statements that you think are relevant. And then I'm going to do another short poll before we stop the screen sharing and have some discussion. So we're curious, after hearing about those core conditions, which ones do you feel like your agency addresses? And this is one where you can choose as many core conditions that you feel are relevant, so you don't just have to pick one. This is where, if you were using that handout or jotting down some notes, as we were describing them, check off all the ones where you marked something off that felt relevant to you. It looks like everyone who's answered is who's going to answer has answered. So I'm going to end the poll. And let's take a look at the results here. So we have, and you might have to on your screen scroll down a little bit if you aren't seeing that last line there. So it looks like most everyone on this call who answered the poll saw or heard something in health and wellness that they felt was relevant to them. And that was followed closely by community connectedness was the next highest one, 83%. And then we've got economic security and mobility at 67%, and thriving families, 58%. And it goes lifelong learning, healthy and safe and just community, healthy environments, and stable, affordable housing and shelter. Right, so we can see that at least each of these core conditions had at least one response, so at least one of you is feeling like that was relevant. And we imagine, even though we're not asking this question, we imagine some of you may have selected multiple core conditions. And so I'm going to stop my screen share at this point and actually invite those of you that feel comfortable and open to it to turn on your cameras, because we're going to stay in gallery mode for a little while. So we always love to see other people's faces aside from our own. And also want to see if anybody would be interested in, you know, if you were using that handout or drawing your own notes, would anybody be willing to hold up your map, your handout for us, and show us your, what you wrote or what you drew, and talk us through a little bit so we can understand like what you felt was relevant to you and where you see some connections between core conditions.
So I have six different programs, and I know other agencies have multiple programs. So I think what I decided to do as I was using my highlighter around here is to sort of create my own spreadsheet. So for each of the six programs, I can hit the elements in the five areas that we do touch. And then hopefully that'll help me craft our applications. I haven't seen the RFP yet, obviously, but hopefully I can make those connections in the narratives and in the impact statement.
Great, thanks. Yeah, I'm glad that you came off mute to share that, because yes, family service agency, and I imagine some others on here, you know, that have multiple programs, it's like you have to be able to think about almost like in multiple dimensions, right? To think about for each one, because the core conditions might be slightly different, or the way you describe the connections might be slightly different depending on what the program is and who the program serves. Yeah, so it's great that you thought about it that way. Would you be willing to talk us through maybe like one of your programs and share what core conditions you felt were relevant to that one?
Sure. I'll get the old reading glasses out for that. But well, I could use, I think, the counseling program, which basically addresses all of the health and wellness impacts, but also helps people that are having difficulty with, you know, self-sufficiency, because they're better able to go out, maintain jobs and help their mobility under economic security. Also under thriving families, obviously they're generally have other people in their family and friends, whatever age group they're in. That program also utilizes volunteers, so there's, you know, kind of a connection in there as well. And in some cases, people have the threat of violence in their home, so that could impact the safe and just community portion.
Great, thanks so much. That was a great example. And you'll hear us again describe more at the end of today's session about some of the upcoming trainings and other forms of technical assistance that we're offering related to the request for proposals and applications. But I'll just mention now that, you know, we're going through this exercise and encouraging everyone to think about all the connections between core conditions and impact areas. But it doesn't mean you have to be measuring outcomes in every single impact area. So like, just wanted to put that out there first so that, there isn't fear or anxiety around it. Like, oh my gosh, now we have to measure, you know, a million outcomes. It's, you know, at this stage, we're thinking about like, what are all the different ways, and almost like, what are all the different avenues or entryways to be improving health and well-being in, you know, multiple dimensions of health. Would anyone else be willing to share their thought process, or if you actually did draw or write on your handout, to show that and share that with us?
I will.
But Chris, and then I saw Eduardo also raise your hand. So Chris, you wanna go first and then Eduardo?
Sure, and this will be interesting because Ed and I both work for the Seniors Council, but we manage very different programs. So the two programs that I'm coordinator for, the Foster Grandparent Program and the Senior Companion Program. So it was really interesting to me looking at the core conditions, how one of the programs might fit in one category, but then there were other categories where they overlapped. So the Foster Grandparent Program, where we're sending volunteers into the classroom, was definitely, you know, meeting a lot of the impacts for lifelong learning and education. Whereas the Senior Companion Program, which is a friendly visitor program with seniors, was, you know, making a lot of impact in health and wellness, as well as community connection. But both programs really support thriving families, where you're supporting children and supporting seniors together. So I really like this, the concept of where things connect and where things overlap. It's really helpful. Thank you.
Nice. Thanks for sharing that example. It's, you know, it's a really good example of, there might be a particular core condition that at first stands out like, oh yeah, that's the one that we most naturally align with. It's most clear what we do that relates to that one. But then kind of as you think through that the connections are changing, you might, I mean, this is at least part of what I heard you say, Chris, that ultimately, right, what you're doing, what you're contributing to might be something else, right? Might be a different core condition. And that's, it's almost like you're building a little logic model, right? Or a little theory of change. If we do this in this core condition to improve or impact this core condition and ultimately do this thing over here. So that was a fantastic example.
Yeah, it's a good map. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Eduardo, you want to go next?
Sure. Hi. First of all, I do want to second what Chris just said, aside from the fact that we work together. It is a great map, and it's very helpful, and it just it's a great visual aid to really put into perspective what we do and what we aim to accomplish on a daily, right? So I did actually, I'm not sure if you'll see it, but I have my map here, and I drew my arrows, as you mentioned. And, Project Scout, our main goal or outcome is to assist people in the community with tax preparation. What does that really mean, right? It goes way beyond just what that statement said, right? We put money into people's wallets, which obviously it's an economic security and mobility issue, right? It supports economic vitality, self-sufficiency, social economic, actually got cut up over here. But pretty much it impacts the four points on economic security. But it also goes down to thriving families. A lot of the families, low-income families that we assist get refunds that helps them with anything from, paying rent on the monthly to, buying school supplies for their kids, right? So that could go even into health and wellness, because we know that, socioeconomic well-being actually allows for mental well-being as well, right? So I pretty much have arrows going to health and wellness, to lifelong learning and education, because we also have a lot of volunteers that that actually assist with our program. And I got a screen here that I think I clicked on by mistake. Community connectedness. Because a lot of our volunteers are prior clients as well, that now are giving back to others. I can't read some of the conditions here on the left. There's healthy environments, I believe, and community. So I think it's safe and equitable communities, individuals and families free from violence and safe households. When there is socioeconomic well-being, that actually usually assists with, better outcomes at home, right? That's kind of pretty much it. I think I've spoken plenty. Thank you.
Thank you. That was another great example, and love that you showed us your little diagram on screen. We could definitely see that. So thanks for sharing that. And I like too how you use that to describe, like, there's the activity, right? The tax preparation assistance, but it's so much more than just that one activity, right? And kind of using the core conditions to describe the ripple effect, right? And the positive benefits it has in multiple, again, areas of health and well-being by doing that one activity, that specific activity. So another great example of how to use the core conditions to really convey, right, the importance and the value and the results of what you do. Thanks for sharing. Would anyone else be willing to come on camera, come off mute, or put it in the chat if you want to put something in the chat? Love to hear more examples of how you use this as you were listening.
Hi,
Angela, you want to go next?
Yeah, sure. So I'm with Teen Kitchen Project, and here's my little, I was kind of expanding it a little bit. So we prepare meals that are delivered to people who are in crisis due to illness or recent surgery. And we engage young people between the ages of 14 and 18 as chefs, either volunteer or paid. So we actually impact the client by offering meals that are delivered. They have a sense of community connectedness because they get to interact with the delivery driver, delivery angel who does a wellness check on them. They hopefully stay out of the hospital, saving, you know, healthcare costs and utilization of ER and things like that. The teens who prepare the meals learn a valuable skill that they can, you know, apply to their own household and as they move forward into the world. They have, if they decide that they want to be an employee, we have two tracks. They can either be a volunteer or an employee. If they're a volunteer, they have an increased sense of connection to community and giving back. And in addition, if they are also an employee, they are gaining income, which they then bring into the community to share. And that this, you know, impacts their families as well, because what we've discovered in with our youth is that they, the money stays within the family and within the community, increasing their economic security. We also have connections between our clients and lifelong learning and education. They receive not only a nutritional analysis of the meals, but also recipes and free cooking classes that they can attend with our registered dietitian. I'm sure I'm forgetting something, but you know, the resilience, the community connectedness, the impact not only on the health of the client, but on all the people that interact with them. Like even the delivery angels report, our volunteers report feeling more connected to community, and you know, and they're not necessarily receiving the meals. They are having that feeling from helping with distribution. So I'm sure I'm forgetting a ton of stuff, but.
That was fantastic.
I love the map. I love this presentation. Thank you guys. This
good,
is great.
Good, good. Yeah, feel free to, you know, I mean, that PDF, you can use it as many times as you want, share it with others. You know, I love some of the points that you were making too, Angela, about, you know, again, so often we think of like, okay, these activities, these services are meant for, you know, this group of people, like they're the beneficiaries. But then what you spoke to also is the other benefits and the results, right, of the people that are providing that or delivering or, and so there's lots of ways to think about, right, the results and benefits of what you do. So that was another great way to incorporate another layer, right, in terms of thinking about and describing not only what you do, but the results of that as well. So thanks for sharing. These are fantastic examples. Would anyone else like to share? Anybody else have an example they want to talk through? How about, did anybody find it difficult to go through this exercise and identify core conditions or identify impacts that you felt were relevant? Anybody find that challenging as we were going through it? Eduardo, you want to say something?
I didn't find it difficult at all. I did find, say, for example, in stable and affordable housing and shelter, I kind of found a different impact that I would possibly like to add. And, you know, obviously, there will always be room to maybe see things differently, right? So that will be my only comment.
And did you want to make your suggestion now? Because we would love to hear it. And if it's...
Well, yeah. So here, I have to look at it again. And as I wrote my notes here and see if I can understand my own notes. So I see that you have impact inventory of housing, availability of safe shelter, access to safe, stable, and affordable housing. I put here as a possible four. Economic assistance or financial means to pay rent or to afford housing, and that's something that we hear a lot from our clients sometimes. That you know, if they get a big refund, that goes directly into paying rent many a time. So it's not something that I felt that was directly connected to any of the other impacts. So I just kind of created a fourth.
Yeah, that's, I love that, that you're thinking about how to make it work and make it relevant. And Nicole will show us in a minute how we've taken the core conditions and these impact areas and put them into a kind of interactive menu that's tied to some data, but we consider it a living tool and a living document that, you know, as we get more feedback and suggestions and ideas about what to add or what could be clearer, like we definitely want to continue improving and enhancing it. So thanks for that suggestion. Did anyone, we've heard some examples of, from several of you about the connections that you've drawn or that you've noticed or articulated between core conditions. Did anyone find that there were core conditions that you felt were completely missing for you? That you thought, we really don't, it would be a stretch to find some kind of connection there, or like our particular program doesn't directly impact that. We really could use some kind of a partnership or relationship or collaboration with someone that does. Did anybody notice any gaps like that? No gaps? Everyone feels like they've got all the connections between core conditions that are necessary? Did this little exercise spark any ideas for anyone about where it'd be beneficial to increase or strengthen connections between core conditions, either within your own program or again, through collaboration with others? Eduardo, did I see your head nodding or was that just a, yeah? Want to share what came up for you in terms of where, like, ideas for strengthening or creating new connections?
I'm sorry, were you talking to me or?
Yeah, it looked like you were nodding in agreement that, yeah, you had some ideas that came to mind.
I agree that it, again, it just, to see it visually, it helps to, you know, re-strengthen those values and those goals that you want to achieve. And also it actually allows you to possibly better partner with others, where maybe before you kind of were bypassing some of those goals and not necessarily seeing how they parallel some other, community partners. So I could see it being helpful, yeah.
All right, thanks for that. Anyone else find that new ideas were coming up in terms of how to strengthen or articulate that connection between core conditions within your own program or with collaborative partners? Actually, that's a kind of a slightly different question. Do any of you feel like you could see yourselves using something like this with other partners you work with, other agencies and other collaboratives to kind of do it as a group thought exercise? See, Eduardo is giving a thumbs up.
Yeah, I noticed how many of you used language about maps, that this was a map or, you know, a way to show kind of where you are. And by the same token, you know, what Nicole's describing is you could have conversations about where you'd like to be that might be different from where you are, in terms of where those connecting lines are and those partnerships, or maybe not. Maybe the what you're doing now is exactly where you want to be, which is great. But just as a way to have those conversations, and some of you mentioned working with volunteers, you know, showing where your work fits into this larger picture, and using it that way as well. It's great to see it resonating with people in terms of both your current work and other ways of thinking about your current work. So we'd love to hear that.
Well, I'm thinking this might be a good time to, I'll bring the slides back up. Do you want to talk about?
Yeah.
Data share, the results menu.
So you'll see a link in the chat. And if you haven't been to data share recently, it's a place that is constantly updated with new information, new indicators, although there are still some gaps. And you'll see, if you look at the core results menu on data share through that link, all of the core conditions we just went over and the impacts are clickable. So you can click on those and see the kinds of indicators that are associated with each of those impacts. So some of those will have some current data available or trend data, you know, showing trends over various years, but a lot of them still have some gaps. And that's because this is partly a wish list of where we would, as a community, hope to have more and better data, more nuanced data, data with equity dimensions, data that shows different parts of the county in different ways. So all of that is still very much a work in progress, but where we do have data for indicators, you can find them there, and they're organized. They're pulled from the rest of DataShare, which is a broader platform for different kinds of data, but they're in this part of the data share platform, the core results menu, they're tied to the core conditions that we've just been talking about. So you might find that helpful. We will be doing more training in TA specifically on how to use the results menu and the indicators within it. But if you haven't had a chance yet to explore data share, it has a lot of great tutorials embedded in it. There are other kinds of local data and local progress pages. You can create dashboards. It's got a lot of user-friendly data utility. So if you find working with different kinds of data intimidating, you are not alone. And this is a place that has some really great tools. It rewards spending some time with it, the site overall. But we just wanted to call your attention today to the core results menu portion of DataShare, which makes it really easy to find what is available and might give you some ideas about things to track or different ways to think about what you're doing in terms of any kind of articulation of outcomes or results, thinking about what kinds of data might or might not be available to you and what you might do differently to understand different dimensions of what you're doing. So again, it's offered in the spirit of there's always something to learn and always something to think about differently in terms of what we're doing. But even when we don't have all the data we wish we had, we can still think about some ways to move forward and look at each core condition and the impacts within it, but also, again, these connections we've been talking about. So encourage you to spend some time there if you haven't already, and also to check back, because there are probably new items added throughout DataShare on a pretty continuous basis. So if you don't see something that you need or would like to have, there are also ways to make suggestions and to upload some of your own reports and data that you are collecting as well, and share that more broadly with others. So you'll just see a lot of different options for looking at, collecting, interpreting, sense making, et cetera, data about our county. So great resource to have going into the RFP, but for other planning purposes as well. So any questions either about that or any of the ground we've covered this morning? Just feel free to ask in the chat or raise your hand. Okay, not seeing any at the moment, but we'll hang out for a bit too after we go through our next slide. And so if you have questions, feel free to offer them. So we did want to let you know, as we said at the outset, there are a variety of core institute events related to the RFP release. And the first one is actually a county event. We are doing the technology of getting people into the Zoom room, the registration piece. But on Wednesday, December 1st in the afternoon from 2 to 4, there will be a request for proposals applicants conference. And that's to go over the different parts of the RFP. So once you've had a chance to look at it, that's a place to listen from the Human Services Department and the City of Santa Cruz interpretations of the requirements in the RFP and start collecting and answering questions. On Friday, that same week, December 3rd, from 10 to 11 in the morning, there's a training that's specific to the online application platform that's called Reviewer, and that's Reviewer with no E, no second E. And that's the online application software that you'll be using. If you're not able to use that for some reason, there are options, but that's the place to start learning about Reviewer and how it works and just getting familiar with it. And then the following week on Monday and Wednesday, December 6th and 8th, there will be trainings on developing a theory of change and a logic model, a different kind of map with an equity lens. And that's related to the, some of you may have attended trainings in the past through the CORE Institute related to those tools and concepts, but we will be going over them again and connecting them to the CORE conditions as we just went over. So those will be happening in December. There's a full calendar of other RFP related training and TA opportunities at the link that you see there in the chat and on the slide. And we will keep that updated. There are also some opportunities to sign up for office hours and individual training and TA. So just keep that in mind as you start reviewing, if you're interested in that kind of TA and training, as you start reviewing the RFP, collect your questions and think about what kind of specific assistance you may need. But we'll be working with you on understanding the concepts behind the RFP and how they relate to the CORE conditions over the next couple of months. So we'll all have to pace ourselves and we've got holidays in the mix and so forth. But we, again, hope that these tools that we're going over that are mentioned here and will be in upcoming trainings, that they're being shared now because they're particularly relevant and useful for the RFP. But even if you're not an applicant for the CORE RFP funding, we hope that you will still find them useful for other kinds of planning or maybe seeking funding from other funding sources or just for looking at your programs in a different way. So while these are relevant to the RFP, they're not exclusively designed just for that. So hope you find that to be true as well. And Nicole has put a feedback survey up. So we really count on your feedback. We pay a lot of attention to it. We hope that you'll complete this survey. And we always love to hear from you. So if you have other comments for us that aren't captured this way, please let us know. And we will hang out, as I mentioned, for a few minutes because we have the rare situation of wrapping up a little early. And just really want to thank everybody who came today and listened, but also especially for those of you who shared your examples. It's really great to hear how these things translate into your work on the ground. And so thanks for sharing those with each other and with us.
Thanks, Nicole. And I'll just mention too that link that Gisella put in the chat, the santacruzhumanservices.org, that's also where you can go to find the actual RFP, the request for proposals. That takes you to the Human Service Department's homepage, and then you'll see right at the top a link to find information about the CORE funding opportunity. And that's where you'll find the RFP and all the training information.